So, well, we had some questions about the requirements from the national grid, and the connection requirements, I would say, are the baseline for flexible operation. This is the first introduction of two presentations from SPK today. I will have a short brief about what is system challenges and what is flexibility. Sometimes flexibility is more of a really fluffy word and say that we need more flexibility. But what is it really? And it needs to be based on the laws of physics, of course. So we are still on the quite high level yet, and we will go down and be more focused on the frequency control after our break. So the purpose, that you understand why we need flexibility, what kind of flexibility. Is flexibility always a good thing? I would say, it needs to be in the right way, and we need to have enough flexibility, I would say. And we will also talk about how from system design to product catalog, how do we design the product catalog that we call the market-based ancillary services? And then we also raise the question, what is an ancillary service then? And is that the only tool TSO can use for system operation? So we start with, what is a TSO? What is the, we call, system responsibilities? Well, we have like four golden steps, we can call them. We are in charge of keeping the balancing in the system between production and consumption in the short time. We also maintain voltage throughout the power system. We need to control power flows and avoid congestions to make sure that we can transport power from A to B and use our power lines. We need also to maintain the rotor angle stability to make sure we have no oscillations in the power system. And this is the four main steps. If we fail with one of those, or several of them, we need to make sure that we can restore the system as well, to build it up again. Some people ask me why, when it comes to operational security, because that's our responsibility as a TSO, when does it end and when does it start? In what time aspect do we have this responsibility? And the really easy question, the really easy answer on that question is always. We need to adapt the system over time. The power system is more than 100 years old, and it's changing quite a lot since it was built. And we need to make sure that we adapt it over time as well. And now we see new system challenges, and we need to adapt this. This is nothing new. We have done this before. As Matthias was describing, the nuclear power plants was doing the load following during the 80s, some of them. And then there was base load because the needs from the power system was changing. And now we see changes again. But we also have one more thing we need to consider when we do this. We need to have this as cost-effective as well. That's really important, because we are a monopolist in this system as well, and we are using all the money from the connecting parties in the system. So when you're saying that you want ancillary service and want us to create market-based solutions and so on, think about that one, because we need to look at how useful an ancillary service really is before we create them. So it will achieve to the operational security of the power system. So just to make a quick example of what is system challenges and what is flexibility and how do we do all those four steps then. This is a normal day. This is the new normal, we would say. This is based on data from 2017 in August, because this was when we had five nuclear power plants in operation. This will be one of the best scenarios after 2021 when Ringhals 1 and 2 also have closed down. So you can consider that one, we assume that Forsmark 1 here was in planned outage. So five nuclear power plants, that's one of the best we can have. You can see here, it's quite nice for the how to transfer power from SE2 to SE3. It's quite much of air in the snit over there. And also here from SE3 to SE4, it's quite much we can move forward if the needs from Europe will increase. But so what is SVK talking about? This is nice, we can do this. This is no problem at all. Well, we assume that we have an N-1 fault. Ringhals 4, it's not even the biggest one. It's 111 megawatts approximately, depends on the year and so on. What will happen when we take out one of our large power producers? Well, of course, we need to make sure that we can replace the 1100 megawatts. And we will do that from north to south. But also here, what happens in the system is that we will have power going down to the west coast. And that will be loading the power lines in much more heavier way than before. So we will have problems with congestions on the west coast here that will limit our capability to transfer power from north to south. And also we hope that Norway will give us some more power as well instantly. And also we see here in the from SE3 to SE4 that we have to lower the transmission capacity quite much due to both the congestion here, but also to voltage stability as well, because you take out one of the synchronous generators really fast. So here we hit the max. We have nothing more to give to Europe or SE4 if they want. So this is, we are hitting the limit. The margins are getting smaller and smaller in the system. But that's not all, because depending on the situation in the power system as well, the frequency stability can be challenged as well. And here we have, depending on what kind of reserves we have connected to the power system, and how big they are, and depending on the import, export, and how much wind and load is connected, it can be a really a summer day. We have problems with the inertia level. Andreas Westberg will talk more about this, why this happens. But then we can be forced to limitate the output of the biggest fault in the system to make sure that we can handling the rock-off if we have an N-1 fault once again. So as you can see, we need to be more active as a system operator when we have normal faults. Before, we had lots of margins in the system and we could quite easily just sit there and elaborate in our own system, but now we'll be more impacted. So one more really easy example we had last year. We had overfrequency during May, 9th of May 2018. And that was quite a wake-up call for us, because then we talk about ancillary service and market-based solutions. Here we had the market-based solutions, what we call MFRR, for down regulation ended. We had no more bids to go for. We had no more ways to actually handle this situation and make sure that we go back to normal state for voluntary bids. So we had to make a phone call to Ringhals and force them down to make sure that we took the system back to normal state. No one wants us to be up here over 50 hertz for so long time. That's not okay. And we need to make sure that we understand that when we make impact, we go in and elaborate with the system. We do that because we need to take it back to normal state and make sure that we have the laws of physics intact and know what we are doing. So to summarize this, we see increased need of flexibility when it comes to frequency, voltage, and power as well. It's not only the frequency control and 50 hertz. The margins are getting smaller and we need to be more active as a TSO and step in. You can describe this. Our role is to make sure that we maintain this box and we will release capacity to the market as long as the market is inside this box. What will happen, do you think, if we move outside this? Well, the worst thing we can do is that we can break anything. We had this perfect example of Chernobyl. It's not a good thing. And I think we also had some events when it comes to hydropower as well, when we have touched the physical limits of the connecting parties in the system, and that's not okay. So during a year, you can say that this box will change due to seasonal variation. It's quite normal. But system challenges will move this box and also make it smaller, less margin, but also move it so we have new technical aspects. So as you saw in the example before, we need to go in and limit the capacity, the adequacy of the power system, because to maintain the technical foundation intact so we can transfer power from A to B in a safe way, so we will not break anything in the system when we do that. So when you talk about security of supply, you also mentioned that we have less adequacy in the system, decreasing adequacy in the system. And that will also need to be included, that operational security is depending on the adequacy, because that's we're using all the connecting parties to make sure the system is stable and has within its operational security limits. So if you take away the adequacy for the production capacity, for example, you take away our tools to maintain the system in normal state as well. So it's a double challenge, I would say. So how do we do that? Well, we have a method, of course. The defense in depth, the nuclear power industry knows this really well. We also stated for the complex power system as well. It's a common theory of how to prevent, protect, and mitigate events. And it's a state-based approach as well. So you look at the criteria to be in normal state and alert state to prevent and have margins in the system. And you also have the emergency state. We have our system defense plan. And if we have anything that will make make these three defense in depth fail, we will have a plan how to restore it and take it back to normal state. This is really important because our role is to make sure that we can keep the system in normal state or take it back. System challenges with less margin will make us move faster between those system states. And we need to make sure that we can take it back to normal state every single hour of the year. So how do we find that flexibility in the tools to keep the system in normal state then? Well, as you can see in the example, we are using the abilities from connecting parties. And that's really important to talk about now because we have the nuclear power's role is changing, and we also know that the hydropower fleet will upgrade soon as well, and we need to make sure that we can have a dialogue and talking a good understanding of how these connection requirements affecting the operation of a power plant and the construction of a power plant. You can see the example for nuclear power here as well, that these abilities for frequency and power adjustment and voltage and rotor angles are quite heavily impacting the whole power plant. And it's the same for wind and hydro and so on. So the dialogue how to construct and the impact of retrofitting already existing power plants is really important to make sure that we can have a good understanding of and good cooperation with industry. But also when we are designing our ancillary service to keep the system in normal state, we need to consider it the basic requirements. Because we can design an ancillary service, of course, and then we have no one with the ability to participate in such a market, and that would be kind of a failure, I would say. So we need to make sure that we can go back to the basics and see, is this really reasonable? So remember that. So the tools then, and we talk about ancillary service, well, that's in the bullseye, the voluntariness. We have the marketplace where you can go in and put a bid in it. But our responsibility as a TSO is for all system states, of course. And we have different obligations depending on where we are. If we are in emergency state, well, then we need to go in and really take great measures, countermeasures to make sure that we can take the system back to normal state before it breaks. Because over here in the emergency state, I would say it's quite ugly production environment for anyone who's connected to the power system. And we do not want to be there because there is where we challenge the limitations of any construction connected to the system. So that's really important that we understand that it's good for everyone to be here in the green field. And everything we do is motivated and justified to make sure, because we are using the system money, of course, make sure that it will be really good for the operational security. So it's really not a market, because it's market-based. If we fail here in the normal operation and go up to alert state, then we are obligated to force the system back to normal state. And here it's really important that we talk about what's obligated to provide features to the power system and what is voluntarily for the market-based solutions. So we make sure that we are in the green field. And here you also can see an example for how we use different abilities in different states and the names of them. And also we have criteria for changing system states. I will not go into depth for that because I don't think I have time. But so just so you know, we have robustness criteria as well for the N-1 fault, and we have criteria for observability as well. It's not only the operational security limits. Just remember that. And this is only for frequency. We will have the same chart and criteria for power and voltage as well. So our tools then are market-based. We have some sort of a line here, we can say market-based is not really a clear statement. When do we have market-based? Well, we have ancillary service here, which Andreas will talk more about. What are they? Well, they are really voluntarily, we have a market-based and we will buy them from day to day. And it will make sure that the owner of the power plants or those who operated the power plants are the ones in charge of saying when it's best for them to put in a bid and participate in those markets, and they also decide what kind of price they want to put in, and then it will be competition. And here we have remedial actions procured in competition and remedial actions not procured in competition. If you want to state what happened in Chernobyl, do you know what kind of tools were used? I would say that it was the remedial action as a connection requirement. It was something the TSO or the grid center just pick up the phone and said, you need to do something. And without, here's the really important that we have the consideration of the safety of power plant. And when we talk about nuclear, it's nuclear safety, of course, that we will not step outside any typical limits that will challenge nuclear safety. So we need to have a good understanding of this. So why do we want market-based solutions? Of course, because we want to make sure that those who knows each power plant the best will put in a bid when it suits them the best, and the risk of doing anything that will challenge security or safety of any new connecting parties will be decreased as much as possible. So we really want market-based solutions. That's not a question about it. But sometimes it's really hard to make sure to construct them. So just to elaborate a little bit more about market-based ancillary service and the laws of physics and our four golden step as a TSO, you have the three frequency, voltage, and power here. And how do we procure tools to make sure that we have a good and safe enough operational security, I would say. Well, we have here in frequency, here's our market-based ancillary service, but we also have remedial actions here, and the colors are corresponding to the system states, because we need to have tools in each system state so we can, if the first one fails, the next one will step in and so on and so forth until we build the system back to normal state. So if you look at one nuclear power plant, they contribute to almost every system state with abilities. If you look at the blackout state, what kind of required abilities do you think the nuclear power plants can contribute with? Well, they are contributing with house load operation, of course, because that's how we see it. Then I know the nuclear power plants are using the house load operation from time to time as well, but the requirement from our point of view is to make sure that we can handle a blackout state. So just to give you a sense of what we are doing and why we're doing it and when it's market-based and not market-based. And the foundation of this is the requirements, connection requirements. So, and here they are, the requirements. There are quite many, and they are lots of pages. I think Kalle has read them all, haven't you? Almost. You lose a piece of your soul each time you open one of them, I would say, but you need to, and they are good. Here we have the connection requirements, which states what kind of flexibility we have. And here in the operation guidelines, they say guidelines, but still laws, so it's not really a guideline, say how we're going to use those abilities and capabilities. And then if it's suitable to do it in market-based, well, then we go to the market code, because then we need to have these competitions and openness and transparency for a real market as well. And here we have defined our role as a TSO and the role of a power producer as well. So to make sure that we can do this and adapt the system, we need to make sure that we have track of what we can do and what is expected of us. And also, I know that some are quite, unsure of what to expect of SVK as a TSO. Well, then I will recommend to go in and read, because it's stated here, to give you a reasonable expectation of what we can do and what we shall do. So this is our common language in the power system. Use it. And here's some, for your reading pleasure, some articles. So, but MPP and flexibility then. Well, we have done quite a lot of work recently. Last year, because we see all the system challenges and we know that we need to step in as a TSO and be more active. So we started the work with the nuclear report, and we have also been a bigger part in the GINA program and Energiforsk, and we need to include more actors when it comes to flexibility and make sure that everybody is aware of the system challenges and that the power system is changing once again. And we need to have knowledge. I would say that's the key. And here we need to understand the limitations and why they are there and make sure that we keep the box intact and do not step outside it. And we will continue to do this over the year as well. And I'm really pleased that we are here because this is an important part together, everybody, and make sure that we can talk within the nuclear industry and with the TSOs, but also it's really nice to have the hydropower industry here as well to make sure we lift up this question and see if we how we can interact with each other and learn from each other. And also the international perspective, because we are not the first one to go this way. So knowledge is really important. But I want to say, if anyone say flexibility, please help me and broaden the aspects of flexibility, even if this seminar is focusing on frequency control. We need them, voltage and power as well. So, conclusions. We need to manage system challenges, and we need to be more strengthened in our role as a TSO and make sure that the operational security limits are intact. It's really important, and we know that we need to be SVK 2.0, and we need to make sure that we keep track on them and with less margins as well. And we need to make sure that this arrow here in between are handled to make sure that we can have operational security and have used the system in the best way, even if the adequacy side will not be in line with the demand. So this is what we are facing. We need to open up and be more transparent and make sure that everyone who's participating in the power system can take part of a reasonable amount of information to see how it's actually the status, the system state is in real time, but also in see the development and make sure that they can act in a better way to be more preventative. So, and also keep track of the definitions. It's to make sure the limit over here, because it's quite hard sometimes to make sure when we talk about what is market, what is market-based, what is not market-based, what's an ancillary service, and what's a remedial action. It's quite evolving to have a new language forced on you from the European Commission, but it's good because it's common. And we can talk to both, we can talk to countries in Europe and we can talk with each other inside the country and everybody will use the same language. So I see them as a good step when we're going to handle the system challenges and all the changes, because it's really important. So, thank you very much. That was all for me. Now I have to moderate myself, I guess, and ask for any questions before coffee break. Mattias or Monica maybe wants to.
The acronym that you use, TSO.
Excuse me?
The acronym TSO that has been used.
Transmission System Operator, stated in the directive.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's nice to listen to you. Now, you said there was one action alert last year. I wonder if there has been any special situations between the connections Sweden, Denmark, Germany, since I've seen quite a lot of discussions about what is Sweden doing.
Discussion about what Sweden is doing. Well, it's been, we have daily events
it
we need
is,
to handle.
It's been discussions about that Sweden is closing when they are not allowed to.
We did that once in January 23 to keep the operational security limits. And when we look back at it, when we have that was to make sure we keep the limits within its operation security boundaries and criteria. But that was a really bit of a... When I listened to our operational manager, that maybe was a bit too harsh measure to take in that point of time, but it's easy to say that after the event happened, but we make sure that we was focusing on the operational security. So, but we are looking into that as well. It happens once this year, I think in January 23. Yes. So, but we have more events where we have left normal operations since 2018. It happens. This was just one example from May.
Lin Saarinen and Vattenfall Vattenkraft. Can you go back to the picture where you had the grid codes?
The grid codes.
I think you put the connection codes in yellow, and I guess you mean that they are not market. The requirements there are not market based. It's requirements
it is
for connection.
For abilities.
I just think. Don't you think that a lot of the requirements in, for example, the RFG is also actually connected to the market services like FCRN
yes,
and FCRD.
They are connected.
Yeah. Could you maybe comment something around that? Like, when is it connected to alert state and when is it market-based? And because there's, I think there's confusion in the RFG, actually, about
this. Yes, it's not. I was sitting in the development group for the connection codes in the ancillary, and we see much potential for improvements, you can call them, to make sure that they are in line with the market codes and the SOGL, as well operation guidelines. But here you can see, this is for frequency. You have the ancillary service, FFR, FCR, and FRR, market-based, which is called FSM. It's more of a rough requirement in the RFG, and then you make additional requirements for the ancillary service, but they can't be separated totally, as you understand, but you have different requirements for kind of different connection as well. We have all these categories for A, B, C, and D. So it will vary who is participating in which one, in which state as well. But then you have alert state. It's quite the same requirements as in normal state, but they will be used with different parameters, but the requirement-based requirement is the same. And that will be the same for the emergency state, which is called in RFG, LFSMU, and LFSMO as well. But in the power plant, it's quite the same. It's just different parameters. And we need to understand this and develop this in a more way. So we will use this ability from a hydropower plant, for example, in a reasonable way, depending on which state we are in at the moment. So it's not quite easy, but this is how we have structured it, and when you look at RFG and the SOGL in combined, you will get this, and also the market code. So when you're reading the codes, that's why, I'm going on the wrong way, sorry. You need to read them all together. It's really hard to read the RFG and see how are the TSOs going to use this when you do not read the SOGL or emergency and restoration code. And then if you've consider how do they structure a market-based solution? Well, you need to go over here as well. So, and you need to have this in the foundation as well. So they are building on each other. And it's quite hard to read it. But if you look at the VERAs inside the codes, they are referring to one another. So you need to have the holistic approach. So was that kind of an answer? Or...
Small follow-up question. Do you think that the requirements concerning, for example, 2 second time for frequency response, is that actually connected to the alert state at all, or is it mainly actually connected to the normal state response time in normal state?
Normal state. It depends on the requirements for the FCR and so on, how the system is developed as well. Because this is the foundation. The connection code is the foundation of the all the tools we can use, and then we can tweak the requirements for FCR in some sort to make sure that the system gets what it needs. But the requirements in the market-based solutions to participate in those can't be too far away from the connection codes, because that's the foundation of the construction of the power plant, sort of. So it will develop and it will be changes, but not too much from them. So, I think that was...
Yeah. And if you have more questions, write them down on the paper and save them for this afternoon.
Yes.